Welcome to another episode of Leaders Arise. This is Demola Owoyele, always bringing you powerful, life-changing thoughts on leadership that will help you up your game and that will help you become all that God has ordained you to be. I've always wanted to say thank you, all right, for joining me every now and then on this platform where we get to discuss the subject of leadership. And today, I want to talk on something very powerful. And I've titled it, The Heart of Following. The Heart of Following. Now, this discussion is very important because it is my observation that a lot of discussions have been going on, or have always been made on leadership, but maybe very few discussion on followership. All right, so I know somebody say, I thought I came to Leaders Arise broadcast to be a leader. I want to teach you how to be a follower. And as a summary of what I'm talking about today, I know books have been written on art of leadership, ART. I am here to discuss with you on the heart of following. ART of following. The heart of following. The art talks about the skills. Alright, it talks about the way and manner something is done. Alright, just the way you have learned about the art of leadership or the art of leading. That means the way and manner that leadership is done. So today, I want to teach you about the art of following, meaning the way and manner following is done or following should be done. All right, let's get started. So wherever you are, get yourself a cup of coffee. Find a comfortable place to sit. If you have friends who are around you, signal to them to join you on today's episode of Leaders Arise. And of course, if you are on Facebook, help me host a watch party on Facebook right now. And invite your friends to come and enjoy this leadership discussion with you. Now, let's get started. Now, when we talk about following or followership, what do we mean? And why is following important to leading? My answer to you on that is very simple. You may want to write it down, and that answer is this. You can best lead to the extent that you follow. Can I say it again? You can best lead to the extent that you what? Follow. So it suffices to say that every leader is a follower and every follower is a leader. Please don't forget, because you may not read this in a lot of books. You may not have been taught this over time, but I'm here to teach you this because I've noticed and discovered over the years that this is often not talked about whenever leadership discussions are being made. You can best lead to the extent that you follow. Great leaders are great followers or good followers, and good followers are great leaders. So what do I mean? When you see anyone that is exuding a leadership capacity, leadership competence anywhere, you are just looking at somebody who has actually followed. In the same vein, if you are looking at somebody who is a leadership failure today, you are looking at somebody who had failed in following. I will say it again for emphasis. If you see somebody who is a super, amazing, all right, relevant, great leader today, you are just seeing somebody who has succeeded at following or who has been a great follower. And if you see a leadership failure today, you are seeing somebody who has failed at following. That's the first thought I want to tell us today. I want to share with us today that you can best lead to the extent that you follow. You can best lead to the extent that you follow. Great leaders are great followers or good followers. And of course, good followers make great leaders. I feel like saying this a million times. Great leaders are good followers. Good leaders are great followers. All right? Or good followers are great leaders. Great leaders are good followers. Good followers are great leaders. So if I see anybody who is following today, it's a matter of time. I'm seeing the leader. Okay, have you wondered why it was Joshua, all right, that actually, you know, I was talking about Caleb and Joshua, I think the last episode, all right. Joshua actually succeeded Moses anyway. And so have you wondered why it was Joshua that was asked to succeed Moses? Why not another person? Why not Abiram? Why not Dathan? Why not other people in the camp? Why Joshua? Do you know why? The answer is simple. Read it in Numbers chapter 14 and some other part of the scripture. Joshua was asked to take over from Moses, I think, primarily because Joshua was a follower. Yeah, Joshua was a follower. Joshua was a follower. In fact, when you check the Bible very well, you will discover the Bible said wherever Moses went to, Joshua followed him. In fact, for your information, while Moses was at the mountain 40 days and 40 nights, you know what Joshua was where? You know where Joshua was? Joshua was at the base of the mountain waiting on Moses. While other people went to their homes and said, don't mind that Moses, his wahala is too much. Don't mind that pastor, he's too work-driven. How can he go to the mountain 40 days as if we don't have any other job we are doing? How can he come to the office Monday to Saturday, always working? Don't mind him. I'm going back to my own house. I have wife to take care of. I have children. I have this one. That was what other people were doing. But there was a Joshua that abandoned himself to following. There was a Joshua that was following sheepishly. He will not depart from the temple. He will not depart from the temple. And anytime I remember this statement, he will not depart from the temple, talking about Joshua, I remembered my lifestyle when I was still a member of a local church. Of course, I'm a member of a church, but I'm privileged to be the lead pastor of a church, Destiny Impact Church, over here in the city of Akure, Ondo State, Nigeria. But I remember when I was a member, not a pastor, not even a leader, as you want to call it, of a local church. I remember that the way Joshua did not depart from the temple, I also did not depart from the temple. Say, pastor, does it mean that you were in the temple 24/7? No, what I meant was, I will not leave church until my pastor left church, or my pastor leaves church. You know, there are some church members that we say benediction, they have already taken reverse to go. Before you say Jack Robinson, they are in their car, or they are even at home already. Brother Demola, where are you now? I'm at home already. Now, I'm not saying you are a sinner, but I'm just saying that. I'm just remembering the story of Joshua. I wouldn't depart from the temple. I remember. You know, by the virtue of the schedule of most pastors, I don't leave church, but not quite recently. Sometimes 3 p.m., 4 p.m., there was time I left church to 7 in the night. And I've been in church since early morning. I didn't leave until 7. Can you imagine if I had a Joshua around me? That Joshua too would not leave church until 7. That was what I did when I was under my pastor. That was what I did. I wouldn't leave church until my pastor leaves. Most times I'm the one. And what am I doing? Nothing. So the pastor said, if I don't leave church, what should I be doing? Just sit there. My pastor will be in the office, counseling, doing office work. I will be in the auditorium, sitting down. And you know, the good thing about that is that my pastor will say, Brother Demola, okay, you are still there. Okay, Ejoewa, please come. He will give me some small assignment to do. Sometimes he will send me on an errand and say, go and buy this for me. Sometimes he will say, hey, Brother Demola, do you notice that brother that came to service for the first time this morning? Hey, can you? There are some things my pastor shared with me. I'm writing a post on my about my pastor. I think I should be doing that. Okay, maybe I've done that. Maybe you follow some of our Destiny Capsule Daily Devotional that I learned ministry practically from my pastor. You may want to check my Facebook timeline. All right? My pastor, my platform, and my productivity. I learned pastoring primarily from my pastor. Do you know why? It wasn't that he was teaching me pastoring on the pulpit as a message, but because I was a follower, there is what I call after-service gist or after-service message. All right? My pastor will be sharing stuff with me. Why? I stayed behind. Leave church 3 p.m. or whenever my pastor leaves, I'll be the one to close the door of the church. Am I an usher? No. Most times the ushers will have gone home. I am not an usher. I was just a teenager in church who is yearning for growth and development. A follower teenager. I pray for you. May you be a follower teenager. May you be a follower youth. May you be a follower married man or married woman. Because following is not a function of age or status. Elisha followed Elijah. And theologian told us that Elisha, I think, was older than Elijah. So it's not about age. Elisha was married, I suppose, with children. Elisha was an established businessman. Before he joined Elijah, he was plowing with 12 yokes of oxen. That's, in our today language, he had 12 trucks working for him in his firm. And he had servants. So he wasn't a pauper. He wasn't a non-entity. He was a high caliber or high status someone. But he followed. So no wonder Joshua was asked to take over from Moses. Why? He was a follower. No wonder Elisha took over from Elijah. He was a follower. Elisha was not like the sons of the prophets that weren't following, they were only commenting. Now, I want to challenge you today or encourage you, don't follow commentators. Because in every activities of leadership, there will always be commentators and there will be followers. Commentators can be gossips or people that gossip. Commentators can be people that just run their mouth trying to give a report about what is happening. That was what the sons of the prophets were doing. They were commentators. They were commentators. Commenting on the latest. Don't you know that your God is about to take your master away? Don't you know Pastor Demola is doing this one? Don't you know? Don't you know our boss is about to be transferred to the New York branch? Don't you know? Don't you know? And they are running their mouth commenting. Listen to me. Leadership does not belong to commentators. Leadership belongs to followers. So why the sons of the prophets in 2 Kings chapter 2 were running commentary, like we say. Elisha was following. 2 Kings 3 verse 11. They said, where can we find a prophet that can tell us what God is saying? 2 Kings 3 verse 11. They said, this is Elisha that poured water on the hands of Elijah. How did they describe Elisha? They described Elisha as a follower. Somebody was pouring water on the hands of Elijah. And those people said, no, the word of God is with him. Let us hear what he has to say. Why? Because while he was following, grace has rubbed off on him. Followers are grace carriers. Can I say it again? Followers are what? Grace carriers. You want to carry grace for leadership, be a follower. I'm teaching you what I know. I'm teaching you what I've practiced. I'm teaching you what has worked for me and what is working for me. You want to be a great leader? You want to be a grace carrier? Be a follower. If you ever want to be a great leader, look for somebody to follow. Because some of you, followership or following will not come automatically. You may not see who to follow. You may not come naturally, but you have to look for one. People look for leadership platform today. Why not look for following platform or followership platform? Say, I want to attend that. I'm looking for where I can lead. No, look for where you can follow. Because your following is a description of your leadership future. You cannot lead to the extent that you are followed. No wonder in the gospel, Jesus Christ said, follow me and I will make you. We are first of all called to followership. Amen. We are not called to lead, we are called to follow. But inside following will leadership come out. Can you imagine what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 11 verse 1? He said, follow me as I follow Christ. So who was Apostle Paul? A follower. I know anytime you hear about Apostle Paul, say, oh, an apostle, a great leader. But Paul never described himself as a leader. He described himself as a follower. Can I ask somebody today, what are you describing yourself with? Are you describing yourself as a follower or you are describing yourself as a leader? You know, I belong to a pastor's network, a group, and a US-based group on Facebook where pastors all over the world, they share ministry experiences. So somebody was just making bringing up a joke, one of those, I think 2 weeks ago or last week. The person said, why? Okay, it's just a joke, really. He said, so in some pastor's title, you have lead pastor. Person said, if you are not the lead pastor, then what are you? Is there something like a following pastor? So I say, senior pastor, is there something like junior pastor? Now, what does that, you know, it's just a joke, really. But somebody now said, I would rather be a following pastor. Meaning that I'll be more conscious of my following than leading, in the sense that I'll be more conscious of my followership of Jesus, followership of other people that God has placed ahead of me, that I am more conscious about the fact that I'm lead pastor. I'm a lead pastor of Destiny Impact Church. But I'm saying today that you are going to be a lead pastor to the extent that you are a lead follower. I should be proud to be called a lead follower. Just like some people will be proud to be called chief servants. How many of you have heard that before? Chief servants. Chief servant, not chief executive officer. Now, don't get me wrong. This is not to say if you use chief servants, chief whatever. It's not about the title. It's about the mindset. So I'm not saying that if you are using lead pastor. I use lead pastor. You can use general overseer. I am not disputing that. It's not about those accolades or title. It's actually about your mindset. That even if your title is lead pastor, know that you're also a following pastor. Do you understand? You are chief executive officer. You are also a chief servant. Is that clear? So what I'm saying in essence today is this. You can only lead to the extent that you follow. That's number one. Number two, when you see a great leader today, you are seeing a good follower. And whenever you see a good follower, you are seeing a great leader in the future. The third thing I want to mention as I begin to unpack the art. I have not started talking about the art of following. I'm just talking about following. Then I'll now teach you the art. How can you follow profitably? How does following make a great leader? Because you can be following in quotes and you are not a leader. Or you don't become what you're supposed to become. Alright. So let me discuss this third point with you about the fact that in every human being, listening to me very well, in every human being, there are two tendencies that God placed in every human being. The tendency to lead and the tendency to follow. Please write it down. There are what? Two tendencies that God placed in every human being. The tendency to lead and the tendency to follow. If any of these tendencies is missing in your life or in somebody's life, that person is not healthy. You know, some people, the only tendency inside of them is tendency to follow. There is no tendency to lead. You are not healthy. So what does that mean? A healthy human being is a human being that wants to follow, but that also wants to what? Lead. Are you following me today? So you are not healthy if the only thing you want to do is to follow. You enter a place, say, me, I just want to follow. Me, I don't want to take responsibility. I don't want to lead. You enter a workplace, you enter a church, you enter a place, me, I just want to follow. You are not healthy. It's not a sign of humility, it's a sign of, I don't know what you want to call it. Let me not use the language I used to use. Normally, it's a sign of stupidity, but some people get offended when I say that. I'm not saying that to abuse you. I'm just saying you are not thinking the way you should think. A stupid person is not somebody, it's not an abuse. It just means that you are not thinking the way you are supposed to think. So that's why I say it's not a sign of humility, it's a sign of stupidity. That means not that you are humble. It's just that you are ignorant of the basic truth about following. So in every human being, two tendencies. Number one, tendency to follow. Number two, tendency to what? To lead. And for you to be healthy, those two tendencies must be operating in your life at the same time.
Hey, whether you are a young person, you must have tendency to follow, tendency to lead at the same time. Whether you are a juggernaut, big person, great guy, that have gone decades in leadership, you must always have the tendency to follow and the tendency to lead at the same time. It is God that plays that tendency. And for some of you that have children at home, you will agree with me that right from the childhood, you will have been noticing those tendencies. I have children at home. I notice that my children, they want to follow. They also want to lead. Oh, and I love to see them display those tendencies. They want me to do things for them, and they also want to do things for themselves. That's a healthy child. A healthy child is a child that wants to do something for him, but also want to do something for himself. So if you ever have a child that always wanted to do something for him, he doesn't want to do something for himself, you have to help that child, because he's going to grow to be an abnormal child, meaning that he won't be the leader that God has ordained him to be. And if you also have a child that doesn't want you to do something for him, he doesn't want to follow your instruction, he doesn't want to allow you to do stuff for him, he always want to go his own way, always want to do stuff for himself, it's not a sign of strength, it's a sign of problem. Because in every human being, God has put those two tendencies, tendency to follow, tendency to lead. It doesn't matter what area or strata of life you are in, you always must have those two tendencies working in tandem in your life. So how does these two tendencies work? Very quickly, number one, the tendency to follow will naturally trigger the tendency to lead. And also the tendency to lead will also trigger the tendency to follow. What do I mean? As you are following, you always want to lead. You are following. That following always want to stir you up to take up roles, responsibility. And the more you lead too, the more you have that, did that leading want to trigger following? And that's why some of us who are in the pastoral ministry, even though we are lead pastor, we also have a lead pastor we are following. We have Jesus we are following. In fact, the more we grow in ministry, pastoral leadership, the more we also want to follow Jesus. If you ever see any pastor who says, me I've grown in those days that we still used to follow Jesus. Who are you following? If you are no more following Jesus. I have done 60 years of ministry, so you see, I'm used to this thing. I don't have to inquire from God. I don't have to ask for direction. I've always done it. One of the most profound statements I've ever heard about leadership is the fact that there is no expert in leadership. In leadership, everybody is a learner. Say, I'm a learner. I had this in 2011 and it changed my leadership forever. There is no expert in what? Leadership. Everybody is a learner. There is no what? Expert in leadership. So the fact that you have been leading, pastoring, whatever, for 28 years, for 60 years, remember, you are still a follower. The tendency to lead must trigger the tendency to follow. The tendency to follow must also trigger the tendency to lead, because there is no expert in leadership. Everybody is a learner. And when you are a learner, you'll be a leader. And when you are a leader, you'll be a learner. Can I ask you today, are you a healthy person? And how do you describe health? Tendency to follow, tendency to lead. Tendency to follow triggers, tendency to lead. Tendency to lead triggers, tendency to follow. So what am I saying in essence is this. Following is not altogether bad. Following is a part of the mix in leadership or of leadership. Some people see following as a phase of life. That in those days when I say used to follow, there's nothing like that. You are forever a follower. Say amen to that. No, we say God forbid. No, it's not God forbid. I've just explained. I am proud to be a follower and I am forever one. I know you want to say you are forever a leader. Say congratulations. But as much as you want to embrace the fact that you are forever a leader, can I encourage you to embrace the truth that you are forever what? A follower. Because following is not just a phase of life that you graduate from. You cannot graduate from following. Yeah. Even though you can now follow differently, but you can't graduate. Now, I am still a follower, even though I'm a leader of a local church, but I'm following differently. I may not have a pastor that is over my head every Sunday, every Wednesday, that gives me instruction. I was like that before. But the fact that I am no longer like that does not make me not to be a follower. I am following, albeit differently now. I'm following God. I have a spiritual father I'm following. I have a few other authority figures in my life that I am following. I'm following their wisdom, their counsel. I'm following their instructions. I'm following their way of life. I'm following their examples. Why? Because my leadership will be as strong and potent as my followership. So write down that fourth point. You cannot graduate from following. You are forever a follower, and the earlier you embrace that truth, the better for you. So don't see following as a weakness. See it as a strength. Don't see following as something that is derogatory. If I say, how many followers are here? Raise your hand. Some people will hide their hand and say, no, me, I'm not the follower. It's not a bad thing to follow. It's not a bad thing to follow. It's not a bad thing to follow. As a wife, follow your husband. It doesn't reduce you. It enhances you. As a pastor, follow God. Follow the Holy Spirit. Follow advice from other people. As an employee, follow your boss. Don't always want to engage in power towards you. Following is not a weakness. Following is strength. It is wisdom, not weakness. Following is not a weakness. It is wisdom. Always want to follow. Always want to follow. Always want to follow. You want to see a safe human being, you should see a follower. Followers are safe. All right, don't follow somebody who is not following another person. That person is not safe. Don't follow somebody who is not following another person. That person is not what? Safe. All right? Don't follow somebody who is not following what? Another person. That person is not what? Safe. No wonder Paul said, follow me as I do what? As I follow Christ. So it stands to reason that you are not qualified to be followed unless we can see that you are following somebody else. And as a follower, don't follow somebody who is not following somebody. That's why every pastor must have a pastor. Every leader must have a leader. Every father must have a father. In the context of our discussion. Now let me teach you about the art of following in the next 5 minutes. How do you follow? Number one, recognize your leader per time and see him or her for who he is or she is. You can't follow if you don't recognize your leader. A lot of people today don't recognize their leader. Everybody is their friend. Everybody is their mate. Everywhere you find yourself, always recognize your leader. I'm sorry if I had to shout that at the top of my voice, because you can't follow if you don't know your leader. Your boss. In fact, like I tell people, everywhere you find yourself, ask yourself, who is the leader here? Who is the leader here? And I will shock you by saying that there are some people who are leaders around you that you don't even know. Pride has covered your eyes. You can be among your friends and you have this wisdom that, no, this guy is the leader here. He knows what I don't know. Is that clear? He's the one that is here before me. He's the one that has the wisdom to drive this enterprise. Recognize your leader wherever you find yourself. In a local church, recognize your leader. At workplace, among your friends, even in the family, recognize your leader. Because if you don't recognize your leader, you will not follow well. Number two, if you don't recognize your leader, you will fall for the wrong leaders. I taught in our local church some couple of months ago. I spoke about real leaders. I spoke about representative leaders. I spoke about rebel leaders. 3 R: real leaders, rebel leaders, representative leader. If you don't know the real leaders, you will likely fall for rebel leaders. So recognize your leader per time. In every context, in every situation, in every place, know that person that is the leader over your life. Number two, don't struggle with your leader. What do I mean? When you recognize your leader, just follow. It's as simple as that. Your leader may not be younger than you, follow.
Your leader may not know as much as you know mentally in terms of you are a PhD holder. He is not. Follow if he's your leader. I wonder how people get to the hospital and they follow just anybody. You see a 22-year-old young doctor. Say, Oga, lie down on the table. Okay, sir. He lies down. He doesn't argue. It's only when we come to church or workplace or some other places that we argue with ours. How many of you argue with your doctor? Open your mouth. Very well. Do you argue? No. Open your clothes, remove your clothes, bring out your buttocks. Ah, do you understand? Your doctor give you prescription, use this drug 3 times a day. You will follow his instruction, am I correct? Because in that context of medical practice, he's your leader. And you have recognized him to be one. And number two, you followed him. Am I correct? So when you recognize your leader, don't struggle with him. Whether in the church, whether in the family, whether in the workplace, whether among your friends, don't struggle with your leaders. Number three, follow the right things or learn the right things in your leaders. And that's why I'm talking about the heart of leadership or the heart of following. Some people don't know how to follow. They follow the wrong thing. In Hebrews chapter 13 verse 7 and chapter 13 verse 17. Chapter 13 verse 7 says, remember those that have the rule over you who have spoken the word of God to you. He said, whose faith follow considering the end of their conversation. So Hebrews 13, 7 told us to remember or recognize our leaders, but he told us what to follow. He said, follow their faith, not their fashion. Did you get what I said? Don't follow their swag. Follow their substance. Don't follow their style. Follow their principles. Don't follow the way they dress. Follow what they read. Because people, what people read make people, not what they wear. If you like, go and buy 3-piece suit like your pastor. It doesn't make you one. Go and buy the latest of suit and tie as your boss at work. It doesn't give you the thinking of a boss. So don't follow his fashion, follow his thinking. So follow the right thing. Verse 17 of that Hebrews 13 says, all right, I said, obey them that have the rule over you. All right? Because they watch for your souls as those that must give account. So you don't only, all right, recognize your leader, like I said, you obey them. And number three, I said, you follow the right things. Because in some cases, in an average leader, there are a lot of things in them. Choose what to follow. You know, that's why leaders have to be careful. A pastor can mount the people and say, look at this Gucci suit. I bought it for £35,000. God is faithful. Somebody is looking at you and say, God, the God of Pastor Damon, you must give me Gucci suits or Gucci whatever. That is not... Now, the pastor might even be saying that, I don't even expect the pastor to say that anyway, innocently. But it's passing the wrong message across. But you have to be smart and wise not to learn the wrong things. You must be smart not to learn the wrong things. Follow the right thing. You know, you can have a boss who is a womanizer. And that boss is also an expert in the field of telecommunication. Don't humanize with him. Follow the telecom skill that he has. When he's going to club at night, I say, Demola, can we go together? I say, my wife is waiting for me at home. When he says, can we go to the library? Can we go visit those clients? Follow him. You are following the right things. Don't follow the wrong things. All right? Follow the right things. Don't follow their faith. Don't follow their weakness. Follow their strength. That's why leaders are not perfect sometimes or most times or all of the times. They have strength. They have weaknesses. They have things they are unconsciously showing us that may not be beneficial to us. But we must be wise enough to ensure that we are following the right thing. The last but not the least, because my time is up. I don't know, because I'm always short of time in Leaders Arise, because I've got a lot to say within the brevity of time allotted me on this broadcast. The final thoughts I want to share with you on the art of following, all right, is to be a committed follower. Don't take a vacation from following. I'll give you two classic examples because of time. The first is the story of the story of Elisha and Elijah. Elijah kept telling Elisha, go back, the Lord is calling me to Jordan. calling me to Jericho, Elisha said, as long as the Lord liveth, I will not leave you. The same thing for Ruth and Naomi. Naomi told Ruth, go back. I have nothing to give you. Ruth said, wherever you go, I will go. Your people shall be my people, and your God shall be my God. Following requires commitment. Don't be a fair weather follower. Don't follow when the road is easy. And when the road is challenging and difficult, you back out. Follow through thick and thin. Follow through high and lows. Follow when there are goods to share. And follow where there are challenges to navigate. So don't be selective, as it were, in your season of following. Follow every time. Because every season in the followership journey is supposed to add something to your life that will make you the kind of leader that you are supposed to be. Thank you for joining me on today's episode of Leaders Arise. I do hope that this broadcast has been a blessing to you. I encourage you today to be a committed follower. Ensure that the art of following you have learned today, you bring it into your daily life, whether you are in whatever area or field of endeavor that you might find. You have questions, you have comments, you have feedback, feel free to get them across to me on the contact details being displayed on the screen. And of course, help follow this live this page, Facebook. If you are on YouTube, subscribe to that channel. If you are on Miss Ella, follow the Miss Ella channel. Then also help us to share this stream across all your platforms. And of course, I have materials and resources being displayed on the screen that will be a blessing to you. Or you may want to go to destinyimpactchurch.org/stores. You will get life-changing materials that will further help you in your leadership journey. Till I meet with you again on the next episode of Leaders Arise, I dare you to be a committed follower. And in so doing, you're going to be a great leader that the world has never seen before. Have a blessed day. Bye for now.